Good morning to all of you. Welcome back to Hospitality Engineering, HVAC Module 2. Today, we will see what are the possible ways and means to do energy conservation in HVAC. What is efficiency? Efficiency is dependent both on the efficiency of the equipment and the efficiency of the system. A system designed with efficient equipment that is used inefficiently by the operator makes that system as inefficient system. In management, any organization often view building and equipment cost very differently. For example, manager of purchasing may look for the most attractive first cost equipment in project, whereas the hotel chief engineer who has to fund the ongoing operations, maintenance and utility costs for the equipment will likely to be more concerned about the long-term ongoing cost. Dealing with variable load. Any HVAC system should deal with the variable load. Why? We will see one by one. Over the period of the day, the system encounter nighttime temperature and humidity plus daytime temperature and humidity. It encounters period of time when the hotel is empty or under occupied or occupied with the expected design load or occupied with more than the expected load. During the weekend, the hotel may operate continuously due to the busy guests or be less occupancy on the weekend, or maybe the unseason in the resort hotel may have the less occupancy. During the year of variations from the season will impact the load the system must deal with. Therefore, dealing with load variation is an important element in an HVAC system. There are the two key factors in optimizing the efficiency in HVAC system. Selection of the equipment and system design taking into account life cycle cost. Managing the system while in the operation. Here if you see, managing the system while in operation is in chief engineer hand, and engineering team can handle very well in this area. Variable speed drive. In a variable speed drive, efficiency gains may be yielded from using a chiller that incorporates a variable speed drive. This would allow the chiller to make more cold water at time of heavy load. During the high occupancy, your chiller should work at the peak load. Less time of the light load, the temperature of the water produced would be the same. But when there is a more water circulating through the cooling coil, the heat that is absorbed from the air will be carried away more quickly, and hence the air will be cooled more overall. Fans, pump and cooling tower can also benefit from variable speed drive. We will see variable frequency drive logic and configurations in our upcoming BMS and IoT module. Mainly, if you see, the variable speed drive has to be integrated properly based on the load and ambient conditions so that your chiller capacity control automatically fluctuate through the variable speed drive. Now, we will go back to the basics. First, in any chiller plant, our HVAC technicians and engineering team should be familiar with the basic concept. Most of the hotel, we have constant primary flow pump and variable secondary flow pump. For example, you can see there are the three chillers. Three primary pumps are there. The other side, you can see three secondary pumps are there. There is a common pipe which is called the coupler. Now, typical load with the two-way valves are in the user side. All the guest rooms and the banqueting, we have the two-way valve is available. We will see the basic rule of the primary and the secondary part. Primary flow must always be equal to or greater than the secondary flow. This is very, very important. So you can see there are the two chiller. When we have the primary pump, the primary flow, for example, if it is 300 GPM, your secondary flow should not more than the 300 GPM. It should be less than 300 GPM or equal to the 300 GPM for the proper basic operations. Now I will take you the one simple example. I'll explain you for different load condition, how do you operate the primary and secondary pump. Consider here the chiller having the 100 TR three numbers. So here 1 TR we need the 2.4 GPM chilled water. So this three chiller, the chilled water, total chilled water requirement is 720 GPM. Now the primary pump, there are the three primary pump and three secondary pump. You see here the supply water is 12 degree Celsius and outlet we have taken as a 4 degree Celsius. When we calculate the total load during the 100% load condition, so you can see the 720 GPM 300 TR is generating. While 100% load condition, the 720 GPM is feed into the chiller, which is taken by the secondary pump, all goes to the user, end user, then it will be back to the primary pump side. There is a coupler, there is no flow in this. So whatever goes from the secondary pack coming back to the primary pump. This happens during the 100% load condition. Now we will see 75% load condition. We have the three chiller, the total load is 300. So 75% we cannot switch off the one chiller. So this condition also we have to run the three chiller. But you see the 720 GPM feed into the chiller through the primary pump, then it's come. But only the 75% of the GPM taken from the second pump through the VFD mechanism. Same time, the coupler is open, 180 GPM comes directly to the primary side. Thus, the chiller load is reduced. This kind of setup as default available in the proper design. However, operation team should ensure what is the temperature coming from the return chilled water, then the supply chilled water plus this GPM. If they don't have the flow meter, they have to rent the flow meter, measure this flow. So this is very, very important in the point of energy conservation in chiller plant. Now we will see during the 50% of the load condition, we can switch off the one primary pump, one chiller. Still, it is more than the 50%. Hence, the coupler is open. 480 GPM is feed into the chiller through the primary pump. Now, it comes 360 GPM outside the secondary pump, which is going to the user side. 120 GPM goes back through the primary pump through the coupler. Here also VFD does the job in the secondary pump side. Now we will see the 25% load condition. Straight away we can switch off the two primary pump and two chiller. Here you can see the 240 GPM is requirement. This flow 240 GPM goes into the chiller through the primary pump. In secondary pump, 180 GPM goes to the load side, the 60 GPM back through the secondary through the coupler, 25% load condition. What are the advantages, disadvantages of the primary constant flow, secondary variable flow? The very good advantage is easy to control for the operation team, easy to commission for the project too. These two things are very, very important for the HVAC plant. If you see the disadvantages, higher pump energy cost, higher installed cost, higher plant energy cost because of the low delta G. We will see other type of the energy conservation measure. For any HVAC system chiller plant, the cooling tower is very, very important. cooling towers are very effective way of increasing the refrigerant effect. In a typical cooling tower at full load, the closed circuit fluid, water or refrigerant can be cooled 30 to 35 Fahrenheit cooler than with an air-cooled coil. This substantially increases the performance of the refrigeration system. Some cooling towers are equipped with axial fan to encourage the airflow. Inefficiency can occur due to swirls in the airflow. An expansive hub seal disc prevents this and can add 5 to 8% of efficiency to the fan performance. Another opportunity is at the tip of the fan blade, excessive or irregular tip clearance causes uneven blade tip loading, reduced air draw, hot air circulation, and repetitive vibrations. Fan blade tip shields reduces this problem. These two measures are very, very important in cooling tower. And also, cooling tower can be equipped with the VFD. Maintenance. In HVAC system, maintenance is very, very important. Ensure that air is purged from the refrigerant if required. When air is trapped in the refrigerant loop, it increases the compressor's discharge pressure. This increases the energy consumption of the compressor. That is the reason we always have to check the suction pressure and discharge pressure. Some chillers have automatic air purger with meters mounting the running time. Tracking the running time each day or week will show if a leak has developed, which is allowing air to enter the system. Ensure the refrigerant level is maintained by checking the refrigerant side glass and the superheat and subcooling temperature readings. Level of refrigerant that are above or below the manufacturer requirement will reduce the capacity and efficiency of the chiller. Minimize the scale and fouling by applying the appropriate water treatment to the chilled and condenser water loop if the system functions all the year. The degree of scaling can be monitored by pressure drop compared to the manufacturer specification. We saw in our last video the water treatment plant. So if you missed out, please go back and see it. Ensure condensate drains are maintained. The chiller may be equipped with some controls to manage the variation in capacity. For example, the chiller may unload during the period of the low demand. This means the motor keeps running, but the compressor is not actually doing the work. This may be combined with the hot gas bypass function, which introduces a portion of high pressure, high temperature gas to the evaporator. This is intended to raise the temperature and pressure in the evaporator and prevent freezing during the low load condition. It is important to ensure these are working properly if present in your HVAC system. Direct digital control. This is one of the very simplest way to reduce the energy saving in the low side equipment. There are a variety of way that system can be set up to take advantage of the outdoor conditions and exert maximum control on the space for efficiency. Examples include nighttime setbacks, demand controlled airflow via occupancy sensor or CO2 sensor, and optimized start-stop of fans and pumps. Direct digital controls can be an effective investment even in retrofit situations. In case your project team or your design, it was not considered, now also you can able to adopt this kind of direct digital control system in your low side equipment. We will see simple idea in our BMS or IoT training upcoming module. HVAC control should be described in a master plan to assure the systems are properly specified, installed, and controlled. Commissioning practices can be very cost effective in this regard. Energy recovery. There are various ways to recover the energy. We will see one by one. It may be possible to implement the heat recovery for the hot water by using a platen free heat exchanger to recover the heat from the condenser. Heat pipes may also be considered. Exhaust air energy recovery may be accomplished by a heat wheel or energy recovery ventilator. The exhaust airflow and incoming airflows are arranged side by side and each flow through half the wheel. You can see the exhaust air and outside air. The exhaust air, the wheel contains a film which absorbs the sensible or total heat from the exiting airflow. As the wheel turns, the heat is transferred to the incoming airflow. So you can see the exhaust cold air comes in the one half, then it gets cooled. When it goes the other side, the outside air gets cold. Exhaust air. The HVAC system usually incorporate a central exhaust system to vent air from the restroom, kitchens, and janitorial closets directly outside, instead of mixing it with the fresh air entering the building. The system that creates the draft for this central exhaust should be interlocked. To coordinate its operations with the air conditioning or heat pump unit, except during the unoccupied period, the central exhaust system should have a motorized damper that opens and closes with the operation of the fan. The damper should be located as close as possible to the duct penetration of the building envelope. This minimizes conductive heat transfer through the duct form and avoids having to insulate the duct. The damper should remain closed during the unoccupied period, with the exhaust fan turned off even when the air conditioning or heat pump unit is operating to maintain setback or setback temperature. Hydronic balance. We always call it water balancing, chilled water balancing in our system. It is very, very important to maintain your energy level. A system which relies on water will benefit from the hydronic balancing. Water is pumped through a system of pipes, walls, and heat exchanger. In a perfectly designed system, each component will receive exactly the required flow. In practice, it is very difficult to predict the real flows. As a result, some circuit will receive the more flow than necessary and other will not receive the enough. Typically, the closest circuit to the pump receives the most flow. Balancing the system involves measuring the flow and adjusting them to the required values. The system includes differential pressure controller and balancing valve to provide for this activity. Balancing is necessary both for energy efficiency and to optimize the indoor climate. Without balancing, control valves will reduce the flow in overfed circuit and allow the overfed circuit to receive the required flow. But if the system is heavily loaded, such as peak heating time in winter and peak cooling time in summer, the control valve will open. And as a result, some circuit will still be underfed. Balancing ensures that the system is not dominated by a few circuits and thus prevents some zones being underheated or overcooled while others are satisfactory. So the hydronic balancing saves the energy because the pump is not doing unnecessary work. A smaller pump may be feasible. Also, unbalanced system have to be started earlier and run for longer. Balanced plant therefore save the energy because they can start and stop at the optimal time. Optimize the fresh cooling with an economizer. Instead of keeping outdoor air to a minimum, there are times when we may want to use maximum outdoor unit. An airside economizer saves energy when outside air is cool by using it to cool the indoor spaces. In Bangalore, you can see the weather start pleasant from November, December, Jan and February. You can use the outdoor unit. When the enthalpy of the outside air is lower than air recirculated from within the building, it is more energy efficient to use the outdoor air. When the enthalpy is higher outdoors than indoors, the amount of outdoor air is reduced to the minimum for fresh air requirement, and air from the space which has been previously conditioned is recirculated. The idea of the free cooling, whenever you have pleasant air. What do you mean pleasant air? Your RH within the comfort as well as your temperature within the comfort. Then you can directly take, you can feed fresh air into the occupancy area, pipe and duct. The heating and cooling effects of the HVAC system are distributed through the building via pipes and duct. To effectively carry those effects to the points of use, HVAC pipe and duct should be in good condition and adequately insulated to avoid losing the energy to the areas where it is not needed. Process pipes and ducts may be a source of load in industrial spaces. They should also be well insulated to avoid increasing the HVAC energy consumption and also to optimize the energy consumption of the process. Thank you for watching. I hope you all subscribe to our channel. If not, please subscribe to our channel. Turn on the notification. If you have any doubt or any suggestion, please email to me. Thank you for watching.